Nighttime on Still Waters. This is NB506812, narrowcasting into the night from somewhere on Britain's waterways.
October 16th, Monday. Frost garlands the ropes and mantles the boat in white. Smoke curls upward from the chimney. Maggie and I breathed the breath of dragons this morning. Two groups of ducks wing in from the north. For a single moment, the cold world is lit up by the tiny fire of kingfisher blue. Banks of angry clouds, thick and heavy, roll over us from the west. And the damp air is turning chilly. It feels cooler than the reading that the thermometer actually gives. And even the smears of light on the water from our windows are shivering. This is the narrowboat Erica, narrowcasting into a storm-chased October night, to you, wherever you are. I was hoping you'd come. It's so good to see you. Come into the warm where the stove flickers rosy and the kettle is on. We saved a seat for you, so come inside and welcome aboard. This week it's been raining, raining a lot. Another low tracked across the country, whipping up winds and auguring successive waves of rain, from grey drizzles to torrential downpours. We're okay and kept dry, pretty much. We found we were getting a bit of water ingress in the study here. We're still not too sure where it's coming in, but a distinct steady drip began to occur from the ceiling. My main suspect is the mushroom vent. These are air vents to ensure a circulation of air, particularly important if, like us, you're using a solid fuel stove. A lot of boats have them. They are brass and in the shape of mushrooms. We were warned that in heavy rain you can get a few drips inside. It's caused by the rain hitting the cabin roof, bouncing up, and then hitting the inside of the mushroom cap to fall down into the boat. This does happen. But it's never really any problem, just a few splashes. However, last year I discovered that the seal around one of the other vents was beginning to break down, and when it rained it allowed water to seep under it and then channel down under the internal wooden fittings. I think this might be happening here. I've had a cursory look, and it looks fine, but I need to investigate when we get some dry days. It's not been a huge problem, and we put down a little container to catch the drips, but it's not good for it to be happening frequently. The thing is, although we've had a lot of rain before, and some of it torrential, we've never encountered such a long period of torrential rain. The storm Babet passed overhead, the sky and the land turned to water, beating upon the cabin roof, lashing the water's surface into a churning mass. The walk to the sheep fields became a shallow lake, and entrances and exits around gates and stiles quickly turned into quagmires. And still the rain fell. The hill just above the canal began to gush with water. Three distinct waterspouts appeared in the waterlogged grass. The largest created a fountain of white water a couple of inches high. Maggie was entranced by it, repeatedly plunging her nose deep into it, so that the water bubbled and flowed up her snout almost to her eyes. A little lower down, the whole hillside had become a stream, before it emptied, gurgling down into the clay bankside. and into the canal. And on Friday afternoon, the water level rose by about 6 to 8 inches in a couple of hours. We had to keep checking that the mooring ropes were slack, in case it rose even higher. This is the type of thing that's expected on a river, but rarely occurs on canals. And I've watched a couple of scary videos tweeted by the Watts on board of water pouring over the lock gates at Droitwich, which is just a few miles west of us. And as night fell on Friday, more rain still fell. Whenever one of us awoke, we check outside. But despite the rain, the levels seemed to be dropping. The canal is now soupy with the crema-coloured swills of runoff soil deposited from the fields. But the water level is almost back to normal. And it's been a full-time job trying to keep Maggie from getting too wet and muddy in an effort to keep her wounds from her operation dry. But even so, one is taking a little longer to heal. And we've been hoping that life would return back to normal this week, but it looks like we have another week before she can be signed off. Well, she's been wonderful, bless her. And she clearly finds not being able to race around off lead or jump up the steps hard. So she's now full of pent-up energy. And we long for her to be able to run as much as she does. And the mud and the wet is certainly not helping. Hello and thank you for getting in contact with me this week. I always make a point of replying, but it's been rather hectic here these last couple of weeks, and I apologize for being much slower than I normally am. But I do read everything that's sent and really appreciate your comments, your news and your encouragement. And thank you to Margaret. And yeah, you're absolutely right, that article did make me smile. And it's a great antidote, as you say, to the many negative portrayals of old age. And it was also great to hear from Martin James, and it was my pleasure, Martin. And Karen Smith, and Nellie, Pip, and Hebe. And Jason, thanks for the extra question, Jason. I'll endeavour to weave it into a future session. And I still haven't forgotten yours, Chris, either, and I hope that you and Alan and the land of Green Ginger are faring well despite the storms, that your journey south hasn't been adversely affected by it all. I have seen, as I said, some pretty hairy videos, so be careful and have an amazing journey. And a special hello and thank you to all our Lockwheelers for supporting this podcast. They are Alison on the Narrowboat Mucker, Derek and Pauline Watts, Anna V, Sean James Cameron, Orange Cookie, Donna Kelly, Mary Keane, Tony Rutherford, Arabella Hodsapfel, Rory and MJ and Kayla, Narrowboat Precious Jet, Linda Reynolds-Birkins, Richard Noble, Chris Ferguson, Tracy Thomas, Mark and Tricia Stowe. Mark and Tricia, I hope you're having a wonderful cruise and that the rain hasn't dampened things too much for you. And, of course, to Madeline Smith. Thank you. There was something magnificent about the sky of inky blues and greys and the oncoming night. Rippling waves of alto cirrus paved a low water cove of grey sandbanks stretching out across the sky out of the west, where hints of watery saffron and lemonade weakly coloured the skyline. Behind, banks of cumulus built up, and under this dome of mettled twilight the rooks flew high, much higher than they normally do at dusk. Much higher than I have seen them for a long, long time, wheeling and surging on broad wings, two distinct groups, merging into a rapturous chaos of precision before parting again, this time into two or three groups to merge once more again. part ballet, part country dance, part Kaylee. There's a storm out west, and it's on its way in, and even now there are whispers in the air, and the rooks are celebrating. They are so high that I can hardly hear their song lifted on that ragged wind. I look up and feel both lifted and soothed. Earlier, Maggie and I came across a shaggy inkhorn toadstool. Its tawny creams ghostly white in the gloaming among the dark green blacks of the meadow. There was something irrepressibly resolute about the unapologetic alienness of its presence. "This is the still center of my universe," it seemed to say. So far, it's certainly been an autumn for fungi. There are places where it's almost impossible not to stand on any. And now, by my feet, is a solitary dandelion. Unabashed in its anachronistic golden splendor. And I can remember those long drawn out cold springs of mud and thin rain, when I longed to spot the first dandelion of the year, and how my spirit soared at its warm sunny flower head. Who needs the sun when here, out of the mud and stones, an earth sun arose that fed the world with its nectar? And now I stand at the opposite end of the year, stopped in my tracks under a crow-wheeling sky by the sunshine glow of the last dandelion of summer. And does it matter? Does any of this really matter? The sky, the crows, the fall of night, and the last dandelion of summer. Is this anything more than just an idle distraction? The fiddle playing while 100 Romes burn and the Titanic slips once more beneath the cold, indifferent ocean. These are the questions I've asked myself at different points in my life many, many times. Perhaps my voice should be more effective, crying out with Jeremiah heartbreak, the casual breaking of the planet, the dawn chorus that each year grows thinner, sparser, and to which on some mornings beats in my ear more like a lament than a jubilant song to welcome the sun. One of the first ecologists, Aldo Leopold, was right when he wrote, "One of the penalties of an ecological education is that one lives alone in a world of wounds." And it's hard to ignore the stabs of loss and growl of anger when I walk the woods and the fields. And yet, it was this uncontrolled anger that began to corrode into my being, which led me to find this joy can still be found even in this broken landscape. A quiet whisper of a joy that was the only thing that was strong enough to contain and divert the rage. And it was that which led me here, physically, geographically, emotionally, intellectually. Among this wreckage, I see eyes, wine dark, and sparkling with life and intelligence. And even scuttling between the puddles and the raindrops, a beetle negotiates the obstacle it meets with a spontaneity choreographed by curiosity, experience, and understanding. It might be not anything like mine, but I recognize it, and am immediately drawn into a feeling of shared experience with it. And I know I'm not alone in this. Chances are you too have experienced this. And it's hard not to when you begin to drift out of the human bubble and find yourself in a world alive with so many others. I love Seán Street's recollection of exactly this in his poem Listening with a Spider from his collection The Sound Recordist. Listening with a Spider. Steady summer rain on a low flat roof. Two of us listening, tense with waiting, each in our corner, and this warm, straight sound. Outside, foliage drinking, the beech trees, the rain given voice by what it touches, what it falls onto when the gutters burst. There are years held in it. And at once now, as always, but time is only this thin, through a low flat roof. And we are sharers. A life is as long as one raindrop's beat, and then the next. We are inside a drum, nothing for it but to listen, locked down. What will we take from this? The two of us. The comfort of the moment in this cave. The kindness of stasis. Safety of it. And at the beginning of this year, during that short but fairly bitter cold snap, the little wooden ship-lapped shed that houses the Elson Waste Point became the home of a huge spider. As the weeks went past, her web got larger and more complex, hanging lower and lower until I had to be careful for my hair not to get caught in it. And on each visit, I expected it to have been swept away and her no longer to be there, evicted. I appreciate that not everyone is perhaps as tolerant of spiders, particularly large ones, as I am. But no, there she always was. And on each visit, I recalled Seán's poem, running the lines through my head, reliving his encounter and that sense of connection. And in her essay, Animals in the Room, Why We Should Listen to Other Species, bioethicist Melanie Challenger ardently calls out the fallacy of human exceptionalism by so neatly capturing this feeling. She writes, "When, in adulthood, my husband and I bought the house in the forest, in all its shambles, we hadn't banked on the way our non-human neighbours would come to matter to us. Yet ordinary everyday proximity to other life forms makes plain that they have vivid experiences of the world around them. The wild lives of other species are punctuated by the dynamism of the unexpected. They aren't endlessly running on algorithms strung to nature's deterministic loom. Animals hesitate if something grabs their attention. They take advantage of a sudden outbreak of sunlight, or not, as they see fit. Some individuals are more curious than others. They make choices between alternatives in ways that are not always predictable and directed by individual character. And this is only possible in beings with agency and feeling. In simple terms, they are gloriously, staggeringly, idiosyncratically alive." I know this is true. I've seen it. I've experienced it. I've felt the shift and tilt of boundaries merging. And it is that which sustains me with the stillness of its joy, which makes me want to find words that can sing and to reach out into the darkness and say, we are not alone. But new storms are raging and a new darkness is falling. And once more I find myself asking, what does this matter? And I know that I'm not alone in finding myself. Over the last couple of weeks, faced with the unfaceable truths of who we are, re-evaluating everything, questioning myself. Who am I? What am I doing? I've been careful to avoid a lot of social media, but the news still hits hard. Listening to a reporter, his voice shaking, saying how he will never be able to unsee what he has just seen. And then, in the aftermath of such unbearably brutal acts, the raging chorus of strident voices, each condemning the other to death. And let us not deceive ourselves into thinking that such acts are isolated. Genocides and ethnic cleansings that regularly sweep across other parts of the globe experience also such traumas. They just don't happen to capture the interests of our media. The words of Thomas Hobbes come down to us, ringing through history, that the natural state of humankind is neither noble nor beautiful, but one, he writes, of continual fear and danger of violent death, and the life of man solitary, poor, nasty, brutish, and short. Is this any surprise, when, as Tennyson puts it a couple of hundred years later, that the reality of this world is not that it runs by the rules of love of a benevolent Creator God, but ones of aggression and violence, a nature that shrieks and is red in tooth and claw. And in the brave new world that Tennyson paints, Hobbes's depiction of human brutishness, if not constrained by state apparatus, fits so perfectly. These grim assessments may not be surprising. Hobbes is writing at a time of social unravelling during the turbulent violence of the English Civil War. He had enough primary data in front of him to convince him that his assessment was right. And Tennyson's world was coming to terms with new sciences, geology, paleontology. And Archbishop Usher's neat dating of the Earth's creation was being swept away by a timeline containing the vertiginous vortex of years, populated by a nightmare of horrific monsters who were, bone by fossil bone, being chipped out of the very bedrock upon which he stood. How can nature be anything else? How can humans be anything else? And our news feeds bear out the truth of those terrifying words of Hobbes and Tennyson. Just look to the Negev. Just look to Gaza. How can I sit here in this darkness, both real and metonymic, and talk about ducks and the trials that swans are facing, or the glorious wheeling spectacle of the rooks? Is this not anything more than an indecently offensive distraction? The telling of pretty stories whilst ignoring the broken cries of the truth? What can be more immoral than to turn a blind eye to the pain of others? The unconscionable callousness of turning away to be dazzled by some petty joy. And Storm Babet has now come, raging in from the west, and it's come just in time, wild, chaotic, destructive, angry. And it seems apt for these days. Tennyson's indifferent, ferocious nature writ large across the skies. If we humans are brutal, then why not our weather? And my outdoor gear is continually wet. And yet I keep finding myself looking for excuses to go outside again, to be battered by the wind, to be deafened by the rain as it beats unending against my hood. I go up the hill to feel its heart. What is it saying? News of flooding across the country is filtering through. Loss of life. Loss of homes. We've been out to check that the mooring ropes are slack. The canal is higher than I've ever seen it. And is this it? The reality of it all? And on the way back to the boat, a large puddle. A worm squirms in it, in its drowning death throes. Instinctively I bend down and scoop it out and place it on less saturated ground. But my action shakes me. Why? Why should I care? But I do care. I do care that in all this wretchedness, that this one worm does not die, not today, not now. And I watch it as it wriggles into a thick tuft of grass. And I feel something. And I don't quite know what, but I feel something. I think it is that I feel a little bit more human. And the images of the rooks circling in their storm dance, and the last dandelion of summer, spring to mind, each acting according to their nature. Simple, spontaneous and unconscious acts flowing naturally from their simple being. The dandelion has no thought of being the last, nor of the significance of that, botanically, biologically, ecologically, aesthetically, or metaphysically. But it is no less beautiful for that, for the sense of summer warmth it brings to a sodden field alone in the darkening greens of dusk. And neither is its acceptance and welcome by the solitary bee and hoverfly and the small circling gnat-like flies for whom it provides refuge and succor any less. And nor does it diminish the joy that I gain from spotting it. The glorious, rebellious light of beauty that will outshine the gathering darkness. And with all this, something still deeper springs to my mind. Something that challenged and changed me in the midst of a maelstrom of darkness. It was a time when I was encountering the fallout of trying to articulate what I could see as the cataclysmic destruction of nature. It was a time when I felt in very real danger of being totally consumed by an uncontrollable rage born from frustration and grief. It was at that time that I came across Max Richter's devastatingly beautiful album, The Blue Notebooks. And one day, reading the liner notes for the remastered 15 years edition of it, I was struck to read how Richter was encountering very similar emotional turmoils on the lead-up to the 2003 invasion of Iraq. And faced with the prospect of such destructive emotions, he took the deliberate decision to channel them into something creative. And about that time he wrote, "As our world spins into something quite frightening, increasingly based on loud and vicious rhetoric, I want to talk about quiet protest." Rather than meeting anger with anger, violence with violence, and the escalation that that will always bring, he took the revolutionary and radical step of meeting violence and hatred with the creation of something beautiful. He set out to raise his voice in the only way that he could feel he could, and create something wonderful, beautiful, joyous, something that touched the heart, to remind the world of who we really are and what we are capable of. That simple expression floored me and changed my life. What is it to be human? What defines us as humans? It's our drive, our impulse, our compulsion even, to create. We take our lives, our environments, our natures, and with them we become creators. Isn't that at the very heart of Western religions and culture? and the Creator God said, "Let us create them in our image according to our likeness." We cannot avoid our creativity. It's our nature. It's our breath. And the tragedy is that we can create harm and devastation, conflict, anger, bitterness and pain. Our inventiveness here knows no bounds. The world stage and our social media timelines are constantly filled with trauma, both unimaginably large and petty. But that does not define us. And after reading Richter's description, I made the conscious decision that no matter the darkness, no matter the pain, the howling, strident voices calling beyond, I will endeavor to fill my part of this darkness with something beautiful. That if I have a chance to do something, then what I want to do is something wonderful. To end each day having worked a little closer to the light that such beauty brings. Finding ways to challenge the darkness with these sparks of joy and life. And since then, I found many, many other people, each in their own way, doing the same. Blooming where they're planted. Being themselves. Living as naturally and as effortlessly as rooks sky dancing under the towering clouds or a dandelion opening its petals at the end of summer. A Hobbes' truth is only half of the truth. He should have gone on to applaud the heights to which those poor and broken people can daily reach, turning theirs and others' hells into paradises, lighting the darkness with a stranger's smile, the offer of a helping hand for one lost person to another. The world, Hobbes' nasty, brutish and short world, is aflame with such beauty, such acts of creativity that turn night to day and hell to heaven. Hobbes told only half the story. The full story wouldn't have fitted his political philosophy of an authoritarian state. And Tennyson was only one more Don Quixote, tilting at the imaginary windmill of an earth invested with a theologized anthropomorphism that could no longer bear the weight of newer ways of understanding the world. And so he simply replaces it with another of the same, only this one lacks the benevolence of a creator god. And Tennyson's brave new world, dripping in gore and violence, is one that can readily accept Hobbes's assessment of unrestrained humankind. In it, the worst of human life is not only rationalized, it is, more frighteningly, normalized. Tennyson paints a dark story of this world. But now, it lacks even the hope of redemption. The voices of Hobbes and Tennyson remain, told and retold over and over again in our newspaper columns and news feeds, writ in large bleak letters across the countless social media posts. And who can argue with them in the light of recent events? But look up. Listen. The unspoken and even unconscious little acts of your living does. Just as do the wheeling dance of rooks, the wonders of the last dandelion of summer, the thrush who stares into the dawning sun each morning, and a million, million, million other tiny moments of being. For it's easy, far too easy, to grimly hold to the half-truths of Hobbes and Tennyson, and to view humankind as a mass of dangerous, selfish brutes, when in truth, each one of us is just trying to find our own way, fighting our own unknown battles. In all our flawed incompleteness, and with all our imperfections, we keep going, trying to make it work. Why? Because we are human, and we cannot help but make a difference in this world, for good or ill, and quite often it's both. Our presence makes a difference. We can create and we can destroy. And our world stands as witness to our terrifying capacity of our drive to destruction. But that is only half the story. Each of us also has the capacity to create tiny, sometimes seemingly insignificant things, small acts of huge consequence. Creating something wonderful, something beautiful. And given the choice of doing something wonderful or destructive with the one life we are given, the overwhelming majority will choose something wonderful. Our prosaic, everyday, often humdrum lives are creative acts of beauty that bring a rebellious and disruptive light that cuts through these clumsy caricatures and stereotypes. It's a light that is uncontained and uncontainable. It subverts and overturns the narratives of violence and suspicion. It's a declaration that Hobbes and Tennyson are only partly right. There is more to us than just barbarity and violence. There is more to this world than just barbarity and violence. Tennyson and Hobbes do not define us. They do not imprison us within the brute terror of their words and worlds. We are so much more than that. And each day we prove it in a glittering kaleidoscope of a myriad of tiny acts of humanity. Just remember, you need a lot of darkness to quench a light, but only one tiny pinprick of light to begin to turn back the darkness. So, what is the point? What is the point of me sitting here in the face of all these unspeakable barbarities that have and have yet to be inflicted, talking into the darkness? It is because quiet beauty is powerful. Quiet beauties of each little action that flow from just being true to ourselves are dangerous. They are subversive. They run counter to the dominant narrative, and they say, no, this is not in my name. We are better than this. Stopping to give way to the other car, a smile to a stranger, taking a drowning worm to safe refuge, stopping under a sky scalded by rooks to revel in the gold of the last dandelion of summer, speaks a better truth. We are more than this, Hobbes. Those rooks are far better than you could ever conceive, Tennyson. I sit here because it makes the darkness a little less dark. The feeling of lostness a little less. Reaching out into the darkness to another and finding there the glint of light. That is what it is to be human and to be alive. Filling the darkness with the unquenchable, rebellious light of beauty. This is the Narrowboat Erica, signing off for the night and wishing you a very restful and peaceful night filled with beauty. Good night. Temperature outside 7.6 degrees. Inside 23 degrees. Humidity 97%. Dew point 7 degrees. Wind direction, west-northwest. Wind strength, 4 miles per hour. Barometric pressure, 991.5, rising. Cloud cover, 76%. Cloud ceiling, 3,100 feet. Precipitation, 2.03 millimeters. Moon phase, 46.9%. Waxing crescent. Day length, 10 hours, 18 minutes. Sunset, 18:01. Sky casting, 7:44.